The Bible is so accurate historically, impeccable. There's no other document like it in the world. Let me introduce you to a man by the name of Robert Dick Wilson. Robert Dick Wilson was an amazing man. He was born in 1856, in the time of the height of the birth of this higher critical movement. He lived some 74 years to 1930. He was an amazing man. At age 25, he graduated from seminary. He had already been reading the Bible in 9 different languages. He knew that God had given him a gift. And seeing these critics throwing their bombs at the Bible and trying to destroy it, he realized that he needed to give himself completely to the study of the Old Testament. And so this was the kind of man he was. At age 25, he looked at the age of his ancestors before him and thought to himself, I'm probably going to live to be about 70 years old. And so I have about 45 years of my life left. And so he decided to divide up the next 45 years of his life into 3 sections of 15 years. For the first 15 years, he was going to study ancient Semitic languages. By the way, he would study and learn 45 different ancient Semitic and non-Semitic languages from the Old Testament. Ancient languages, 45 of them. Well, for those first 15 years, he would study that. And for the next 15 years, he said he was going to give himself to the study of the Hebrew Old Testament. He studied every single consonant. By the way, he says, I've looked at every consonant of the Old Testament. There's about 1.25 million of them. I've looked at every single one of them. And then for the last 15 years of his life, he was going to write and he was going to lecture on everything that he had discovered. God gave him an extra 4 years to give those reports. But he was an amazing man. At 25 years old, he had his whole life mapped out before him. And by the way, he wrote at the end of his life that he followed this pattern to the year by God's grace. He did exactly what he set out to do. He lived in an era of biblical criticism from self-proclaimed experts. See, these men would get up and say, I'm an expert on the Bible. And they would say something that was outlandish, but they weren't doing it from their own research. See, they were quoting another scholar, who was in turn quoting a different scholar, and who was quoting another pseudo-scholar, who was quoting some guy that just hated the Bible. And so there was really no basis for anything that they said. And so he decided that when they talked about all the experts agreeing, he would be the expert. And so he was. And he gave an address entitled, What is an Expert? I can sum up the whole address for you in a couple of words. I am an expert, he would say. I've studied everything, and there's nothing wrong with the Bible. I'm going to give you a long quote here. I ask you to pay attention very closely. He says, if a man is called an expert, the first thing to be done is to establish the fact that he is such. You will have observed that the critics of the Bible, who go to it in order to find fault, have the most singular way of claiming to themselves all knowledge and virtue and love of the truth. One of their favorite phrases is, all scholars agree. When a man writes a book and seeks to gain a point by saying, all scholars agree, I wish to know who the scholars are and why they agree. Where do they get their evidence to start with? I defy any man to make an attack upon the Old Testament on the ground of evidence that I cannot investigate. I can get the facts, if they are linguistic. If you know any language that I do not know, I will learn it. And he did. He learned 45 of them. And he says that after he had studied the Old Testament, this is what he says, I had learned the necessary languages and set about the investigation of every consonant of the Hebrew Old Testament. There are about 1.25 million of these, and it took me many years to achieve my task. The result of those 30 years of study, which I have given to the text, has been this. Listen carefully. I can affirm there is not a page of the Old Testament concerning which we need have any doubt. Take the following case. There are 29 ancient kings whose names are mentioned not only in the Bible, but also on monuments of their own time. These are monuments of stone or marble. These things are written in the stone and buried in the sand for 2,000 years. These are not copies. He's saying we have written in the Bible names of kings. We also have stone monuments 2,000 to 4,000 years old with the same names written upon them. He says, some of these go back for 2,000 years, some for 4,000. And they are so written that every letter is clear and correct. This is surely a wonder. Compare the accuracy with that of other writings. Take the list made by the greatest scholar of his age, the librarian at Alexandria in 200 BC. He compiled a catalog of the kings of Egypt, 38 in all. Of all the entire number, only 3 or 4 of them are recognizable. He also made a list of the kings of Assyria. In only one case can we tell who is meant, and that one's not even spelled correctly. Take Ptolemy, who drew up a register of 18 of the kings of Babylon. Not one of them is properly spelt. You could not make them out at all if you did not know from other sources to what he is referring. What he's saying is this, that the greatest scholars in all of history can't even spell the names of the kings correctly. However, there are 29 names of ancient kings in the Bible that can line up with the stone monuments that are 4,000 years old, and not a syllable is spelled wrong. If anyone talks about the Bible, ask him about the kings mentioned in it. There are 29 kings of Egypt, Israel, Moab, Damascus, Tyre, Babylon, Assyria, and Persia referred to, and 10 different countries among these 29, all of which are included in the Bible accounts and those of the monuments. Every one of these is given his right name in the Bible, his right country, and placed in the correct chronological order. Think what that means. Think about it. Think what it means. He says in his book, Is Higher Criticism Scholarly? He said, I have seen the day when I set out on some Bible research with fear and trembling, wondering what I should discover, but all that fear has passed now. He was afraid that he might discover the Bible was unreliable, but all that fear had passed, because the Bible is great. What's so great about the Bible? It has an impeccable record of history. Not one detail is wrong. It is perfectly accurate in everything that it records. Archaeology is still catching up. The Bible records the past accurately, and what about the future? Prophecy is the next thing. What if you could present Jesus to your friends, take him to work, and say, just talk to him. He'll lead you to the Lord. Peter would speak of a time when he heard God's voice from heaven. Remember when they were on the mountain? And they heard the voice of the Lord saying, this is my son. Listen to him. And Peter refers to that event in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19. But he doesn't say that that word from heaven was the greatest thing. He says, we have the more sure word of prophecy. In other words, prophecy is more powerful than even a voice from heaven. Because with even a voice from heaven, there are some people who say that was just thunder. That's what they did in Jesus' day, didn't they? God himself uses prophecy to validate his own word. Turn over to Isaiah chapter 46. Isaiah 46 verses 9 and 10 say, remember the former things of old. For I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times things that are not yet done. And so God says that he declares what is going to happen before it has happened. A couple of chapters later, in Isaiah chapter 48, we read in verse 3, I have declared the former things from the beginning. They went forth from my mouth, and I caused them to hear it. Surely I did them. And they came to pass. Verse 5. Even from the beginning I have declared it to you. Before it came to pass, I proclaimed it to you. Jesus would say, over in John chapter 13, verse 19, I'm telling you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe. Did you know a quarter of the Bible is prophetic? About 27% of the Bible is prophetic. 8,352 verses of the 31,124 verses are prophetic. Over a quarter. Half of these prophecies have come true. Many of them dealt with the first coming of Jesus. But did you know that for every one verse that spoke of the first coming of Jesus, there are 8 verses that speak of his second coming? What do we know about the first coming of Jesus? We're going to look at Daniel chapter 9. Turn over there. Daniel chapter 9. Daniel was taken captive to Babylon. By the way, even though Jehoiakim burned that scroll because he didn't like what God had to say about the Babylonians, they came. They took over. Daniel was taken. The city was destroyed, but the Lord's word remained. Daniel was taken to Babylon in that captivity. He served the government in the capacity of a public official, but as well as a prophet. The temple had been destroyed by Nebuchadnezzar. Jerusalem was in ruins. There seemed to be little hope. And so Daniel began to pray. And we read in Daniel chapter 9, verse 25, that God is going to give him understanding of the future. We're just going to look at two verses, verses 25 and 26. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the command to restore and build Jerusalem until Messiah the Prince, there shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be rebuilt again in the wall, even in troublesome times. And after the 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off. but not for himself. And the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end of it shall be with a flood. The Greek word that's used there is diaspora. The end of it shall be with a flood. Until the end of the war, desolations are determined. This is such a powerful prophecy that Bible critics don't like to look at it very much. Because we read there in verse 25 that the word came to Daniel that said, "Know this, that from one date to another date, there will be a specific amount of time. From the issuing of the decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until the coming of Messiah, there will be 69 weeks." Well, what's a week? Well, the weeks, the word there that's used is Shavua, and it just means seven. It's not a week like we'd think of it. When I say the word dozen, what do you think of? 12 eggs. But it's not eggs. It's anything. A dozen in our mind means 12. Well, a Shavua in their mind meant seven. And so when the prophet's told you're going to have 69 sevens, what he's being told is from the time that the ruined city of Jerusalem is decreed to be rebuilt again until Messiah, there would be 69 sevenths, or 483 years. Well, the decree would come a little while later. On March 14th, 445 BC, you can read about it in Nehemiah chapter 2, Artaxerxes the king stamped a decree that said, "Rebuild Jerusalem. Go ahead." And so the clock began to tick. And you can go from that date, March 14th, 445 BC, and tick down 483 years, and it'll bring you to the date, April 6, 32 AD. If you want to be more specific, you can even go to the day. 483 years by the day is 173,880 days. And if you start ticking at March 14th, 445, and you go 173,880 days later, you find yourself in Jerusalem, 32 AD, April 6th. What was happening that day? Well, Messiah the Prince was riding into Jerusalem on a donkey. And they were saying, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And so to the very day, it was fulfilled that Messiah would come. But you see, Daniel's prophecy went on to say that Messiah would be cut off. Did you notice that in verse 26? Messiah shall be cut off, but not for himself. The word cut off is the word karat, and it means to be sacrificed. It means to be destroyed or killed. And so Daniel says that he would be cut off. And so Jesus, after he rode into Jerusalem, was cut off. He was crucified, but not for himself. He was crucified for you and for me. He was crucified so that my sins could be forgiven. But with your finger there in Daniel chapter 9, turn back to Psalm 22. Psalm 22 is another prophetic scripture speaking of Jesus. How would he be cut off? Well, Psalm 22 will describe for us in detail the method of execution. In Psalm 22, verse 14, the psalmist writes, "I am poured out like water. All my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted within me. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue clings to my jaws. You have brought me to the dust of death. For dogs have surrounded me. The congregation of the wicked has enclosed me. They pierced my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones. They look and stare at me. They divide my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." This is a detailed description of crucifixion. The elements of crucifixion were a number, but most particularly, they were dehydration. Your joints would be pulled out of socket. When they hung you on the cross, after your strength had given out, your shoulders would pop out of socket. And then after a few more hours, your elbows would pop out of socket. They say the victim's arms would be 9 inches longer than normal because their joints were out of socket. And so when the psalmist writes here in Psalm 22, "All my bones are out of joint. They stare at me. My bones are pulled out, and I can see them where they weren't before." But dehydration was particular. Jesus said, "I thirst," from the cross. By the way, he quoted the very first line of Psalm 22, my God, why have you forsaken me?" in order to point people back to the fact that this was all prophesied before it happened. By the way, crucifixion hadn't even been invented at the time Psalm 22 was written. And so it says there that they pierced my hands and my feet. What are you going to do with that? What are you going to do with that? That is a detailed description 1,000 years before it took place of the cutting off of the Messiah that Daniel would speak about. Well, Daniel goes on to say that after Messiah is cut off, back in Daniel chapter 9, verse 26, it says the people of the prince who is to come, that speaks of the Antichrist, the people of the Antichrist, the Romans, shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. Destroy the city and the sanctuary. So God says, Daniel, from the time the rebuilding decree goes to Messiah, there's 483 years. When Messiah comes, he's going to be cut off, and then they're going to destroy everything that's been rebuilt. And so, as Jesus came into Jerusalem and they hailed him and said, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord," Jesus would come into Jerusalem, turn over to Luke chapter 19, and Jesus would give a prophecy about the destruction of Jerusalem. Luke chapter 19 and verse 41, it says that as Jesus drew near the city, he saw it and he wept over it, saying, verse 42, "If you had known, even you, especially in this your day, the things that are made for your peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes." By the way, that was the day the Lord had made. Psalm chapter 118. Remember what it says? "This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it." And that wasn't just any day. This is also the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. But that was the day. 173,880 days. To the day. That was the day in Psalm 118. And so when Jesus came in, he says, "You didn't recognize the day. This was the day the Lord has made." Also in Psalm 118, it prophesies that the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. And so it was on that day that he would be rejected. And of course, he would be cut off. But Jesus speaks of the city, and he says in verse 43 of Luke 19, "For the days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment around you, surround you and close you in on every side, and level you and your children within you to the ground. And they will not leave in you one stone upon another, because you did not know the time of your visitation." A day or two later, Jesus' disciples would come to him. And in Matthew 24, they would point to the temple and say, "Look how beautiful the temple is." But you see, Daniel said that the temple and the city would be destroyed. And so Jesus would give us further details. And Jesus said in Matthew 24, verse 3, "Do you not see all these things? Assuredly, I say to you, not one stone shall be left here upon another that shall not be thrown down." And so the city would be destroyed, but Jesus gives details. He says every stone will be torn down. Now that was a pretty impressive prophecy. The temple building was an amazing structure. It was built by Herod the Great. Herod, he was actually not the great. He was about 4'11". He was a small man, and having a small man's complex, he built big things, kind of to compensate. He was just a tiny little guy, but he built big things in the temple. In Jerusalem took almost 80 years to complete. It was completed in 64 AD. By the way, when they came to Jesus, they said, "This temple has been building for 46 years or so." They were still building it. It was an amazing building. It was hundreds of feet high. It was made of marble and gold. It was taller than a 15-story building. It took 10,000 skilled workers almost 80 years to complete. It was probably surpassed by no other architectural marvel of that or any day. The Jews would say, one of their proverbs was, "He who has not seen the temple of Herod doesn't even know what beauty is." And so the white glistening in the sun and the gold on the edges of this temple was certainly an amazing thing. The temple was huge. It would accommodate hundreds and thousands of pilgrims at one time. And so Jesus said that it would be destroyed, but he was particular and he said every stone would be torn down, not one stone upon another. 40 years after Jesus' crucifixion and burial, as Daniel said, the city would be destroyed. The Romans did indeed siege Jerusalem, just like he said. And in 70 AD, Titus and the Romans sacked the city. They didn't want to burn down the temple because it was such a great and incredible building. But accidentally, the temple caught fire. And as the temple burned, the gold melted. And as the gold melted, it seeped into the cracks of those giant stones that were stacked one upon the other. When it was all said and done, and the Jews were put down, Titus ordered that every stone would be removed in order to retrieve the gold that had seeped into the crevices. It all happened exactly like Jesus said. Exactly. What do you do with that? How do you say that that didn't happen? How do you discount the Bible? Is it because it contradicts itself, or is it because it contradicts a person? Daniel says the city would end with a flood. I pointed out that the word there used when they translated it into Greek is diaspora. And truly, at that time, in 70 AD, the Jews were scattered, and to this day in history, it's known as the diaspora. The Jews were scattered through all the parts of the world. And there they've been for 2,000 years. But you see, God not only prophesied that the Jews would be scattered. Thousands of years ago, he prophesied in the scripture that they would be regathered and that the nation of Israel would be reborn. You don't have to turn there, but in Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 11 and 24, it says, "Of the nation, I will increase the number of men and animals upon you. They will be fruitful and become numerous. I will settle people on you, as in the past, and will make you prosper more than before, and then you will know that I am the Lord. For I will take you, the Jews, from among the nations and gather you out of all countries and bring you to your own land, land of Israel." And so for 2,000 years, the Jews were running in Romania and Russia and Germany, hiding in Spain and different parts of the world. But then 100 years ago, a movement began, and the Jews began to come back to Israel. In the past 100 years, Jews have emigrated into the land of Israel by the millions. And in 1948, Israel became a nation again. The Bible even says that the Hebrew language would be reborn. For centuries, it didn't exist. I mean, they had Yiddish, but Yiddish was kind of a German language. It really was unrelated to Hebrew. In Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 9, God says this, "I will restore to the peoples a pure language that they may call on the name of the Lord." It was indeed in the last century that the Hebrew language was reborn. A man by the name of Ben Yehuda. There's a street in every city in Israel today named after Ben Yehuda because he decided that he and his children would only speak Hebrew. And so there his kids were running around the street and on the playground speaking a language that nobody knew. They could speak Ethiopian or Russian or German. But what was this language? It was Hebrew. And so the prophecy of Zephaniah 3:9 came to pass. And today the official language of Israel is Hebrew. And the official language of my wife and her parents is Hebrew. They say things sometimes, I don't know what they're saying, but I trust them. And so the language was reborn, just like God said. For centuries, the land of Israel was a wasteland because of deforestation. During the Turkish era, they said that the taxation system was based on the amount of trees that you have on your land. And so everybody cut down all their trees. And the land became a desert and a swamp. And it was filled with mosquitoes and malaria. And it was completely wiped out. But Isaiah said in chapter 41 of the book of Isaiah that Israel would grow trees once again. Now this came 2,700 years ago. Isaiah says, "I will plant in the wilderness the cedar and the acacia tree, the myrtle and the oil tree. I will set in the desert the cypress tree and the pine and the box tree together, that they may see and know and consider and understand together that the hand of the Lord has done this." In the last 100 years, over 200 million trees have been planted in Israel. 200 million, it's probably closer to 1 billion at this time. Forests, where there were once a wasteland. Barren deserts are now green with flowers. The Dead Sea is approached by date palms, and it's just amazing when you see it to this day. The Bible also says that Israel will be fruitful. One of my favorite scriptures is in Isaiah chapter 27, verse 6. "In days to come, Jacob will take root. Israel will bud and blossom and fill the world with fruit." Israel will bud and blossom. The Bible says that Israel will fill the world with fruit. By the way, Israel is just tiny. It's the size of New Jersey. And it's the number three exporter of fruit in the world. How can you say that about this little barren swampland desert in the middle of nowhere? But God said it 2,700 years ago, Israel will bud and blossom and fill the face of the earth with fruit. And it does. It does indeed. It also says in Isaiah 35, verse 1, "The desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose." It's come true. Every year, hundreds of millions of dollars of flowers are exported. You know, we can go on and on. I even had to cut out a giant portion of my notes because I knew that we wouldn't get to it. But the Bible speaks of the past accurately, and it speaks of the future accurately. We could go on and on, but you'll thank me, because we won't. We're going to close with this, though. Heard about a rich businessman who, on a trip to England, discovered many, many years ago a microscope. It was a powerful microscope. And he realized that when he put rose petals or leaves or shards of glass or crystals under the powerful lens of that microscope, he could see things that he could never see before. And it was amazing. And having the money, he decided to buy one of them and bring it back home to America. And he would do his looking and he would do his research. And he was one day about to eat dinner, and it was one of his favorite foods there, and he decided to put that on the microscope. And as he looked down and he zoomed in and he brought to focus, he realized a very distasteful fact was revealed by that microscope. There were tiny microorganisms squirming and pushing their way through his favorite food. Oh, What a terrible discovery. What could he do? Well, he did the only thing that he thought he could do. Destroy the microscope. It had revealed to him a distasteful fact. We would say, well, that was stupid. Just don't eat that food. But he liked that food. You see, but a lot of people will do that. They see their life under the lens of the scripture. And they realize that there's some distasteful facts about themselves. The heart is desperately wicked, the Bible says. And so what do people do? Rather than taking care of the problem, they destroy the microscope. They cut at it and tear at it like Jehoiakim. They say, burn it, get rid of it, smash the Bible, take care of it. But it doesn't take care of what is the real problem, which is our heart. The Bible is reliable. People don't contradict the Bible because it contradicts itself, but people oppose the Bible because it contradicts them. What's so great about the Bible? We've talked a lot about the authenticity of the Bible, the reliability of the scriptures. We've talked about the scientific statements that are found in the Word of God. We've talked about many things that give credence and evidence to the Bible. David would say, "Your word is established in heaven." That is to say that God's word originates in God's mind. The scripture would say that God then inspired, or literally breathed, that word through people who were inspired by the Holy Spirit to write down the very words of God. And that's what we have as we study the Bible. Now let me confess to you, today is going to be a challenging day, because the subject that we're going to discuss is, what version of the Bible should I read? And I promise that I will step on some toes today, and I ask you for grace. It's very difficult for me to discuss some of the Bible versions that we often hold to with religious fervor. But you see, God's word was inspired through the prophets who wrote down that word. What we have today is written in English. Most of us don't read the original Hebrew, Aramaic, or Greek. But that was the language that God inspired. Amazingly, the Greek language went through many changes. And in the days of Alexander the Great, having conquered so much area, he needed to change the Greek language from classical Greek to what we know as Koine Greek. Koine is where we get the word coin. It's a stamp that it's all uniform. And the reason was because the soldiers in Alexander's army had come from such distant regions in the Empire of Greece that even though they spoke Greek, they couldn't understand each other. And so God, in his wisdom, used the Greek language to be distilled into what we know as the Koine Greek. And that's how the Bible was written. And through the apostles, the scripture was written down. And yet, in time, we came to what we have as our translations. And we're going to discuss that a little bit today. Some of the things that I have to say may challenge you. But the scripture over and over encourages us not to be ignorant of things in the scripture. And so if you're challenged, please give grace. Take what I have to say with a grain of salt. There are people on both sides of this debate, people that I respect greatly and I disagree with greatly. And so as I challenge you today, and as you look in your scriptures and we see subtle differences, I pray that the Lord would give you wisdom and give you grace, and that you'd come back again next week. Abraham Lincoln said, "I believe the Bible is the best gift God has ever given to mankind." Patrick Henry, another founding father, said, "The Bible is worth more than all other books which have ever been printed." And it was Napoleon who said, "The Bible is no mere book, but a living creature with a power that conquers all who oppose it." God's word has been challenged from the very beginning. In the Garden of Eden, the first four words that slipped out from the slippery mouth of the serpent were, "Has God indeed said?" Let me read to you from Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 5. It says, "Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, 'Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?'" And he misquoted God's word. He took out from what it said. "And the woman said to the serpent, 'We may eat the fruit of the trees in the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said,'" and now Eve is going to quote God, "'You shall not eat it, nor touch it, lest you die.'" That's not what God said. God said, "You shall not eat it, lest you die." And so Eve made the mistake of adding to the word of God, which always leads to problems. And then the serpent, seeing the woman's misquoting of the scripture, knowing that he had an opportunity, then said to the woman, "You shall not surely die. For God knows in the day that you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. And so Satan, from the very beginning, has always challenged God's word. He's always taken it, and like we studied last week, Jehoiakim, who took the penknife or that knife and he chopped up the scripture and burned it in the fireplace, Satan would seek to snip away at God's word. And it's amazing the way that you can change the meaning of things by taking out a few words here and there. Jesus, when he was tempted in the wilderness by Satan, knowing the word of God, by the way, Satan knows the scripture, would come to Jesus in Matthew chapter 4. Jesus, as you will note, quotes the scripture in response to every temptation. He quotes from the book of Deuteronomy 3 times. But then Satan, in his temptation, comes back and uses the scripture to tempt Jesus. You remember how he quotes from Psalm 91, verses 11 and 12. And he says that scripture that spoke of Jesus, he says, the angels, God will give the angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways, lest you dash your foot upon a stone. But if you look carefully, Satan left out the middle phrase there, to keep you in all your ways. And so what he did in his temptation of Jesus, he said, throw yourself down from here. The scripture says this, but he left out a crucial point. Because to keep you in all your ways meant to keep you in the ways that you would go, but it didn't apply to jumping off a building and being reckless and committing suicide in that sense. And so what Satan does is he leaves a little bit out to change the entire meaning, and he's done it from the very beginning. He's been snipping away. He's been tempting people to do the same thing. Did you know Thomas Jefferson, who wasn't a Christian, he used to cut out parts of the Bible that he didn't like. He'd take a little pair of scissors and snip out, I don't like this part. Or he'd take a black marker and he would black out the things that he didn't like. And so people still like to take a razor blade to the pages of scriptures because they might not like what it has to say. As we mentioned, Jehoiakim did the very thing. He chopped up the scroll that the prophet Jeremiah had written. And yet, Isaiah chapter 40, verse 8 says, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of God stands forever. You can tear up a Bible. You can burn a Bible, but God's word is spiritual. As David said, it's established in the heavens. Every word of God is pure. And even though I might like to chop up a scripture or burn a printing press, God's word stands because it emanates from Him, from His mind, from His heart in heaven. It's a spiritual word. And even though the text, the printing, the black on white might be burned or chopped up, you can destroy the paper, but God's invisible word will never go away. In Matthew 5:18, Jesus said, assuredly, I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one jot or tittle. And what Jesus was speaking about was the letters of the Hebrew alphabet. The yod is the smallest letter. And in Greek, the iota or yoda, not one iota or tittle, which was just a marking on the consonants, will pass away until all the law is fulfilled. In Matthew 16, Jesus would tell his disciples, take heed and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. You see, the Sadducees liked to take away from the Word of God. They were the liberals of their day. They didn't believe in the supernatural, the miracles, or the afterlife, and so they discounted those verses. They subtracted them from the Word of God. And so Satan, as he would tamper with the Word of God, taking away from it, the Sadducees followed suit, and they essentially said the same thing. Has God indeed said? We don't believe that this is literal or that this is trustworthy. On the other hand, the Pharisees would say, let's add to the Word of God. And like Eve, they would say, God says, don't eat it or touch it. Sure, that sounds more pious because it's stricter, isn't it? But it always leads to trouble. And so the Pharisees and the Sadducees would do the very opposite things, but they would still pervert the Word of God. The Pharisees had all of these bizarre rules that they added to the Word of God. On the Sabbath day, they said, you know, you can't work, but this applies to a man who spits on the ground. If you spit on a rock, it's okay. But if you spit on the dirt, you're making clay, so a man can't spit on the dirt. A woman on the Sabbath day is prohibited from looking into a mirror because she might see a gray hair and be tempted to pluck it, and that would equal harvesting. You can't do it. And so they would add to the Word of God all kinds of things, and thus they would pervert it. And so there are those who would add to God's Word and those who would take away from God's Word. And we have to be very careful about that. It's such a serious issue that the very last warning in the Scripture found in Revelation 22 verses 18 and 19 says this, if anyone adds to these things, God will add to him the plagues that are written in this book. And if anyone takes from the words of the prophecy of this book, God shall take away his part from the book of life and from the holy city, and from the things that are written in this book. And so the question comes, has there been any adding to or deletion from the Word of God that we have today? And I'll tell you straight out that I used the New King James Version, and I'll tell you why. I'm glad that you asked. I believe it's probably the most reliable version that we have today. And I'll give you the reasons. I'm not what somebody might call a King James only guy. If you go on the internet and you type in authorized version or King James version, you will get all kinds of strange websites. And the reason for that is there are some people who believe that the King James Version was a perfect translation of the Word of God. That when the King James Version was done in 1611, that the very translation was inspired by God and overseen by God. And that the English result of that was the pinnacle of perfection. It was God's Word in English. And all other versions are perverted or they're satanic. And they claim that the translation itself was inspired by the Holy Spirit, and that all other versions are a perversion. Well, that's kind of ridiculous. The Scriptures were inspired by God in their writing, and they were preserved by God over the years by His grace. But to say that that translation is the pinnacle of perfection in the translation of the Scriptures is a little presumptuous. Actually, it's a lot presumptuous. Especially when you consider that in the original version of the King James, the Apocrypha was included. The Apocrypha is 14 books of the Bible that are not included in the canon. They're not considered to be the Word of God at all. And in the 2 years following the original 1611 version, there were 300 minor changes in the English. And so to say that that version is the pinnacle of perfection is a little presumptuous. As a matter of fact, some of the words in Acts chapter 12, verse 4, the Old King James uses the word Easter. And Easter didn't exist in the days of the New Testament. It was the word Passover in Greek. And so some of the things there are a stretch. And so I wouldn't be considered what one would be called a King James only. But I do, with that being said, think that we have to realize that these early versions of the English language, the King James wasn't the earliest. It was one of many. There was the Tyndale, the Coverdale, the Matthews, the Geneva. These were all translated into English before the King James Version. Let's put our thinking caps on a little bit. How did we come to the English version that we have today? Earlier in our series, we mentioned that the church in Antioch became the center of Christianity after Jerusalem fell in 70 AD. We looked at the history of the church in Antioch. We looked at the copies that were made in Antioch, and there are some 5,000 or so copies of scriptures that we have in Greek that emanated from Antioch. They were also done in Latin. They were done in Syriac. It's known as the Peshitta. Those versions of the scriptures were sound for thousands of years. I mentioned earlier that the copying of the scriptures in Antioch was done meticulously, and the copies that we have are very identical to one another. What I didn't mention is this, that there was a proliferation of doctored texts that the early church fathers had to fight against vociferously. And they dismissed those copyists that would copy the scriptures with deletions and additions to suit their own doctrines. Listen very carefully. In the early church days, in the second century, just 100 years after Christ, there were men who sought to pervert the Word of God to suit their own cultish beliefs. Matter of fact, John in his epistles of 1 John was countering one of those earlier cults. One of the earliest cults, it was known as Gnosticism. Gnosticism sought to marry the philosophy of Greece with Christianity. As a matter of fact, one of the early church fathers, a man by the name of Irenaeus, wrote about these Gnostics. And he says, Marcion, and I quote, by the way, Marcion was called by the church father Polycarp, the firstborn of Satan. He was a Gnostic. And Irenaeus writes about Marcion. Marcion and his followers have betaken themselves to mutilating the scriptures, curtailing the gospel according to Luke and the epistles of Paul. They assert that these alone are authentic, which they themselves have shortened. And so the Gospels were being shortened by these cultists. The church fathers were battling against them. Just 100 years after Jesus and 50 years after the New Testament was written, the scriptures were being attacked by the razor blade. They were being added to and taken away from. Irenaeus also writes this, the heretics boast that they have many more Gospels than there really are. Of course, you've heard of the Gospel of Judas, the Gospel of Thomas, and the Gospel of Mary. These were the Gnostic Gospels, and so the church fought against them. But really, they don't have any Gospels, Irenaeus continues, that aren't full of blasphemy. There are actually only four authentic Gospels written by Jesus' true followers. Now, around this time, a man by the name of Clement of Alexandria established a college there on the coast of Egypt in the city of Alexandria. And the sole purpose of his college was to mix Gnosticism with Christianity. And so the Gnostic Gospels began to emerge, and pagan ideas about Jesus flourished, that he was sinful, that he wasn't physical, he wasn't the first begotten Son of God, but that he was an emanation, a created being that came from God. And all the Gnostic perversions, you can look into it on your own time, but really the idea was that Jesus wasn't born of a virgin, he wasn't sinless, he didn't resurrect from the dead, he didn't have a physical resurrection, and his crucifixion on the cross did nothing to pay for our sins. And so it was a perversion that had to be fought by the early church. 100 years after Irenaeus fought Gnosticism, there's an important man that you should know about by the name of Lucian. Lucian was a powerful influence in a positive way on the scriptures and in church. Lucian of Antioch, if you look up Lucian, you'll find different Lucians. It was a common name, but Lucian of Antioch was born in the 3rd century A.D. When he was 10 years old, Antioch as a city was conquered by the Persian Empire, which was to the east. And the Persian Empire ruled over Antioch for about 15 years. In the meantime, Lucian became very educated, and the Roman Empire regained strength. It strengthened itself, and it fought again and recaptured Antioch. Listen carefully, because what happened at that point in time, Lucian discovered that when Rome came back in, there were bishops that were coming from Alexandria. And the bishops that came from Alexandria had a copy of the scriptures that Lucian realized was completely different than what the Christians prior to that had been reading. And he realized that the scriptures that were in Antioch, where Acts tells us the believers were first called Christians, Antioch, the church of Paul the apostle, the church that sent out missionaries, which for hundreds of years had kept the scriptures and translated them into Syriac, Latin, and Greek. Now being reconquered by Rome, bishops from Alexandria were bringing in different copies of the scriptures. And so Lucian realized something was going on here. These copies of the scriptures had been edited to suit Gnosticism already. Cults were seeking to pervert the Bible and confuse the church. One church historian tells us that in Lucian's day, there were 80 heretical sects already striving for supremacy. And, quote, mutilations of the sacred scriptures abounded because each took unwarranted license in removing or adding pages to the Bible manuscript. So Lucian fought this perversion. He codified the existing texts, the trustworthy texts. He compiled them into what we know today as the Byzantine text. You might call it the Antioch text. Ultimately, this body of manuscript would become known as the received text, Textus Receptus. Now, I realize that we're getting into some scholastic things, but the scripture says, study to show yourselves approved. So let's pay attention and listen very carefully and not fall into the trap of Eve, who didn't know God's word. Now, I'm not saying that because anybody's distracted, but I realize that some of these things are challenging. And in our church, you don't come to be entertained. We come to study God's word. We come to know God's word. Because being entertained, dramas are great, singing is great, but it's the word of God which will endure forever. Now, what about the word of God? Well, Lucian fought it. And he was martyred by the Roman Empire in 312 for his copies of the scriptures. But these scriptures existed for thousands of years through the Dark Ages. There are some 5,000 to 6,000 copies of the New Testament, which were ultimately translated into English from what Lucian had helped to compile. Tyndale was one of the first men who did that. He translated the scripture into English. He was killed by the Roman Catholic Church for doing just that. Finally, in 1611, the King James Version was published. Of course, it was called a masterpiece, hailed as the greatest work of literature, but we mentioned some of the problems that it had earlier on. And for 200 years since that time, it spawned revivals, and then something happened. There was a move to modernize the King James Version into a new version. It would be called the Revised Standard Version. And in 1871 to 1881, a committee met in England to discuss retranslating the scriptures into English. And under the direction of two prominent men in this committee, two men by the name of Brooke Westcott and Fenton Hort, they moved from the received text, Textus Receptus, to a new body of manuscripts, Greek manuscripts, known as the Alexandrian text. Of all the scriptures, of all the copies that we have in Greek and in Latin, from the earliest days, 99% of them are the received text, or the majority text, or the Byzantine text, or the Antioch text, if you will. They are identical, practically, in all of their words, and 1% of the documents comes from Alexandria. Two documents, one found in a monastery in Egypt called Textus Sinaiticus. It was found in a monastery in Sinai. Another manuscript, which was in the Vatican Library in Rome, called Textus Vaticanus, were used by these two men, Westcott and Hort. People fought this. In 1871 to 1881, if you were a Christian, you would realize there was a major battle. Because what was happening was there was an abandoning of the received text and the adopting of a new text, the Alexandrian text. Westcott and Hort are interesting men. In that period of fierce battling over what was being done by leaving the received text for the Alexandrian text, many men and women devoted their lives to prove that the received text was better, and the Alexandrian text was really a perversion. Before we look at some of, and by the way, there are some 6,000 differences between the Alexandrian text, which many believed and fought against as being somewhat Gnostic in their editing, there are some 6,000 differences between that and between the received text. Westcott and Hort, in my opinion, were not even Christians. Why do I say that? Well, they didn't believe that the Bible was the Word of God, first of all. They didn't believe that the creation in Genesis was literal. They didn't believe in heaven. They didn't believe in hell. They did believe in purgatory, but they didn't believe in heaven or hell. They believed that Jesus' death on the cross did not pay for our sin. Westcott believed that Moses and David were fictional characters. He studied and he was fascinated by Mormonism. Westcott's hero was John Newman. John Newman left the Protestant church to become a Roman Catholic, and he brought with him 120 men, clergymen. In the process, Westcott came to believe that the miracles of Jesus were fiction, that they didn't really happen. He liked to visit shrines and pray for the dead. He wrote to his fiancée Sarah how he could have knelt before a statue of Mary for hours on end, if time permitted. He even changed his fiancée's name from Sarah to Mary. He was fascinated by Mary worship. He even wrote to his companion Hort, "I wish I could see to what forgotten truth Mariolatry bears witness." Hort, his companion, was fascinated by Roman Catholicism as well. He had a picture of Pope Leo VIII on his wall, which is important because Pope Leo was the one who claimed infallibility. He said, "Anything I say is the word of God." And so what Hort did is he adopted the, he had his poster on the wall. He even wrote to one of his friends that he bought tickets to the Vatican, and his greatest hope was to kiss the feet of the Pope. And yet at the same time, he didn't believe the word of God was infallible. He believed that the word of God was flawed, but the Pope's word was the word of God. Both men loved to worship Mary. Hort wrote to Westcott, quote, "I have been persuaded for many years that Mary worship and Jesus worship have very much in common." Again, I mentioned that they didn't believe in hell. They had a disdain for Christian ministers, for creeds, and the Word of God. Hort said, "Evangelicals seem to me perverted. There are serious differences between us on the subject of the authority of the Bible." He also referred to evangelical Christians as dangerous, perverted, unsound, and confused. And as a side note, he was a communist who hated America. That should tell you something about Hort. Hort admired two men above all others, Charles Darwin and a man by the name of Samuel Taylor Coleridge. Who was Samuel Taylor Coleridge? Well, Samuel Coleridge dropped out of college to smoke opium. His whole goal in life was to find a way to synthesize Christianity with transcendental meditation. Samuel Coleridge was the one, remember I mentioned higher criticism was spawned in France and moved to Germany. Well, Samuel Coleridge was the one who brought it from Germany over to England. And so he was sort of the new age in the old days. This was Hort's hero. On top of this, during the days of the committee from 1771 to 1781, Hort and Westcott had formed a group of men that were known as the Ghostly Guild. Listen carefully. This was a group of men who would seek to summon the spirits of the dead. They would sit in old, burnt-out churches and call on the spirits of the dead to come and speak to them, which, by the way, is condemned in the scriptures. And on a weekly basis, through the period of time of the revision committee, these men every week would gather to summon the spirits of the dead and seek to communicate with them. Westcott called this the, quote, communion of the saints, meditating in darkened castles until he felt the spirits of the dead surround him. It's pure occult. And these were the men that were put in charge of the committee to revise the Bible. What did they do? They said, let's leave the received text and let's embrace the Alexandrian text. As a result of their influence, the Greek text used for 1800 years were the ones used by those who would be criticized as Gnostics. And these are the manuscripts used for all modern translations of the Scripture, except the King James Version and the New King James Version. It should be said that there are so many deletions from the received text that we can't go over them on a Sunday morning, or in a month for that matter, but we will do a couple. I don't like it when in my Bible there is a footnote. After I read a scripture, the footnote points me to the bottom of the page, and it might as well say, for all practical purpose, has God indeed said? Because what it does say is, most ancient manuscripts do not contain this verse. You've seen that before in your Bible, haven't you? Let me encourage you, ignore that. Ignore that. The most reliable manuscripts do not contain this verse. Ignore that. Because what that is the Alexandrian text was used to translate into English, but realizing that it was so flawed, they had to take from the received text, and when they put those portions in that were deleted, they say, well, they really might not be here after all. Has God indeed said? I don't like it in my Bible when it reads that some versions don't contain this scripture. However, the King James Version is biased toward the 99% of manuscripts that we have from Antioch, the received text, and not toward the 1% that we have from Alexandria. What are some of the differences? Where are there some things that are left out? Matthew chapter 6, verse 13. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This is deleted from the Sinaiticus text, even though it was quoted by the church fathers as early as 165 AD. Matthew chapter 18, verse 11. It's an important verse. For the Son of Man has come to save that which is lost. Some of you are looking in your Bible saying, I don't have that verse there. This is the Lord's commission on earth. Why is it missing? Well, the Alexandrian text deleted that. Some versions will have the verse with a footnote that says, most ancient manuscripts do not contain this verse. In Mark chapter 1, verse 1, it says, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Remember, Westcott and Hort did not believe Jesus was the Son of God, and so it's deleted from most modern versions. It's pretty important. Jesus' deity isn't it, but it's deleted. Mark chapter 2, when Jesus heard it, he said to them, those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I did not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. The word to repentance is deleted in most modern translations, and so it changes the whole mission of Jesus. He doesn't come to call sinners to repentance, he just comes to call sinners. Hey, sinners. How you doing? A small deletion, but it changes the meaning of the text. In Mark 9:44, their worm does not die and their fire is not quenched. It speaks of eternal punishment, of hell, but most modern versions do not have it. Some have it with a footnote. Remember, Westcott and Hort didn't believe in heaven or hell. Mark 16, verses 9 through 20 are missing completely from the Alexandrian text. And so, their version would end with verse 8, Mark 9, verse 8, ends their gospel. So they went out quickly, and they fled from the tomb, and they trembled, and they were amazed. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. That's the end of the gospel in some ancient manuscripts. It was quoted by Irenaeus, the rest of the manuscript, verses 9 through 20. I mean, really, look, verses 9 through 20 have everything in it. The resurrection, the commission, the hope, the command, the mention of hell. But these verses, entire verses, are deleted, even though in 150 AD, Irenaeus quotes this portion of the scriptures as being authentic, and Hippolytus does as well. They're found in all the versions quoted by the church fathers, and they're seen in many ancient manuscripts, but they're deleted from the Alexandrian text. In Luke chapter 2, verse 33, my version reads this, and Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were being spoken of him. New versions read, and his father and his mother marveled. Joseph wasn't Jesus' father. Mary bore Jesus as a virgin. This is a crucial doctrine of the church and of the scriptures. And yet the newer versions, touching upon the virgin birth, that doctrine we hold to, refers to Joseph as his father. My question is this. Did God say anything? Yes, he did. What did he say when he, through his spirit, breathed through Luke to write down? The received text says Joseph, the proper name, Joseph and his mother. The Alexandrian text says his father and his mother. My question is, what did God say? What is accurate? And it doesn't end there. I mean, Luke chapter 2 is all about who Jesus' real father was. Notice in verse 43 there, it says, when they had finished the days and they returned, this is the story where Jesus stayed in the temple, remember, and they went back. It says, the boy Jesus lingered in Jerusalem, and Joseph and his mother did not know it. Many versions read, his parents did not know it. Uh-oh. In verse 48, Mary, when she confronts him, they finally found him. And she says to him, son, why have you done this? Look, notice what she says, your father and I have sought you anxiously. And Jesus turns it around on her. And this is the whole point of the chapter. Jesus said, didn't you know that I had to be about my father's business? The whole point of the chapter was that Jesus was the Son of God and not the son of Joseph. Very crucial. In Luke chapter 24, verse 40, where Jesus shows his hands and feet to the disciples. Remember, the Gnostics didn't believe that Jesus had a physical body or he was physically resurrected. And so it deletes from many of the modern translation this entire verse. In Luke chapter 24, verse 51, the very end, where it says he was parted from them and carried up into heaven. Many manuscripts leave out Jesus was carried up into heaven, and so it ends, he parted from them. That is, you know, that could be interpreted as anything. Well, he kind of went around the corner and ducked behind the hedges, and he parted from them. But it deletes the reference to the physical ascension of Jesus Christ. I think it's important. There are many more. We don't need to touch on them. In Paul's letter to Timothy, one of the crucial ones is that in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 6, the received text says, translated into the King James and New King James, without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. One word, God was manifested in the flesh. If your version reads, he was manifested in the flesh, it says nothing, because everybody's manifested in the flesh. Joe is manifested in the flesh. Bob is manifested in the flesh. The point of Paul is to say that God became a man. It's the doctrine of the incarnation. And so the deletion and change of one word, again, the question is, did God say anything? And if he did he say he was manifested in the flesh or God was manifested in the flesh? That's the question. I think it's important. There are many more. It's important that you just read the scriptures. There's such a danger that we become overcritical on one version or another. And I think it's important. I've had fierce debates with men that I immensely respect. And the question is the devil still trying to attack the Word of God? I think it would be naive to say, no, everything's hunky-dory. It's all great. There is an attack. So we must read and study to show ourselves approved. John Stott, in his book Between Two Worlds, writes, the preacher with a humble mind will avoid omissions and additions. He must refuse to manipulate the biblical text in order to make it more acceptable to our contemporaries. For to attempt to make it more acceptable is to make ourselves more acceptable in regards to popularity. Adding to God's word was the fault of the Pharisees. Subtracting was the fault of the Sadducees. Jesus himself criticized them both, insisting that the word of God must be allowed to stand by itself without plus or minus, without amplification or modification, supreme and sufficient in its authority. The modern Pharisees and Sadducees in the church who tamper with the scripture, discarding what they wish was not there, inserting what they wish was there, they don't heed the criticism of Christ. There is, I am afraid, we have to say, a certain arrogance about the theological liberalism which deviates from the historical biblical Christianity. I've mentioned the problem as a result of the watering down. Paul would say to the Corinthians, we are not like some who peddle the word of God. And the word peddling there really speaks of corrupting the word of God. In those days, there would be wine cellars, and in order to sell more wine, they would cut it with water. And so that's the word that Paul uses. We're not like some who cut the word of God in order to make a better profit off of it. And so the question is this, am I saying that some versions are perverted? Well, I'm not saying that, but I am challenging you to study to show yourselves approved. Study the Word of God. Don't take my word for it. The Bible says that the Bereans were more noble-minded because they checked the Scriptures thoroughly to see if these things were so. Read the Word. I'd rather have a person reading the NIV and studying it and growing in it than to read the very Greek manuscripts and not to live by it. Study your Bible. What version should you live by? Well, that's the version you should live by. Study it. But study other versions. You know, there's another debate to move on from here about what I should use as far as a translation. Should it be a thought-for-thought translation, or should it be a word-for-word translation? Many versions of the scripture have gone from what they say to be a literal translation from word to word to being a paraphrase. That is, they say God really couldn't communicate to us in our day and age because he didn't speak the language. And so we will now paraphrase what the word of God says. What it does leave is a lot of room for personal insertion on some of the doctrines of the scripture. And so many scriptures or many copies, there are some that I will not criticize, and there are some that I would say stay away from. Today's NIV, it's an updated version of the NIV. Don't read it. Or you can look at it, but always come back to a trustworthy document. The New Revised Standard. The Revised Standard was done in 1901. And the New Revised, what is happening today is that there is a desire to include all. In the New Revised Standard Version, there are 4,500 changes in gender and plural. You see, they want to be inclusive, and so if the Word of God says sons, they say children. So when Solomon warns his son, he says, son, beware of the immoral woman. They change that to child because they don't want to exclude anybody. See, the problem is the Hebrew word is ben, it's son, and yet in deference to the culture, there is an inclusion. Also, when they're singular terms, they'll change them to plural. Now, let me point out that Jesus said not one jot or tittle. And what he says there, he refers to the Hebrew letter yod. And then he had an argument, remember, with a lawyer. And to the lawyers and the Pharisees, he said, the Christ, whose son was he? And they said, well, he's the son of David. And then Jesus turns it around on them and said, but how is it then that David said, the Lord said to my Lord? Let me point out to you, in Hebrew, that's one letter, yod. Adon becomes, Adon is Lord, but when you add a yod on the end of it, it becomes my Lord. The Lord said to Adoni, my Lord. And so the entire weight of the argument rose or fell on one singular letter in the Hebrew alphabet. Now, when you argue with lawyers, you got to know what you're talking about. And so Jesus rested the entire weight of his identity on one Hebrew letter. Paul the Apostle, same thing. When he speaks to the Galatians, he says, and Abraham was given the promise, and not to seeds, plural, as of many, but to seed, singular. And so Paul the Apostle, the entire argument of the identity of Christ was based on the singular or the plural. Today's NIV, the updated version, has 3,600 changes in it. 2,000 changes are from singular to plural, to be more inclusive, and 1,600 gender changes. So in the Old Testament, when you read of the men of war, that's changed because it's politically correct to have women in the army as well. And so even though the Bible says men of war, they change it to warriors in order to be more inclusive. Now, I understand the desire to reach out and to include others, but the Word of God is holy, and I don't have the authority to come and stand over it and tamper with the very words. When Solomon warned his son, beware of the immoral woman, as I mentioned, it changes. He doesn't say, my son, listen to me. He says, my child or children, keep your way far from her. Don't go near the door of her house. How else does it change it? Turn to Psalm 34, verse 20. Psalm 34 is a prophecy of Jesus Christ. Remember that the Scripture foretold that the Messiah wouldn't have any bones broken. In the Passover, God said, don't break any bones of the Passover lamb. It was figuring a foreshadowing of Jesus, who would be crucified, but none of his bones would be broken. And the prophecy was uttered in Psalm 34, verse 20. It says, he guards all his bones, not one of them is broken. But in the most recent updates, the translations, the New Revised Standard Version, it doesn't say he keeps all his bones. It says he keeps all their bones. Not one of them will be broken. So you see what happens there? The prophecy of the Word of God in the Old Testament pinpointing the details of Jesus Christ is erased for the sake of inclusion. It's no longer a prophecy about Jesus. It's just he keeps all their bones. And so there are paraphrases and there's translations. I would encourage you to get a translation. Read a translation. Read the paraphrases. You can learn from them. You can experience them. But read a translation. When Jeremiah was commissioned by the Lord said in chapter 1 of Jeremiah, I am watching over my word to perform it. There is a new version of the Bible. It's called The Message. I would advise you to, you can look at that, but come back to reading the scriptures. That's a paraphrase. The prophecy of Jesus in Zechariah 13, verse 6. Remember that? And one shall say to him, what are these wounds in your hands? And he shall answer, these with which I was wounded in the house of my friends. So when Jesus returns and his hands are wounded, it's a prophecy. The Message reads, and if someone says, so where did you get that black eye? They'll say, I ran into a door at my friend's house. It's comical, but it removes the power of the scripture, doesn't it? In John 3:16, the Message reads, this is how much God loves the world. He gave his own son, his one and only son. And that is why, so that no one need be destroyed, By believing in him, anyone can have a whole and lasting life. The change from everlasting life, which we understand is to be life in heaven with God eternally, to a whole and lasting life. In other words, the purpose of Jesus was not come to save us into eternal life, but to save us into a whole and lasting life. Careful, be very careful. In Revelation, when Jesus says over and over again to the churches, "He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." The message reads, "Are your ears awake? Listen to the wind words blowing through the churches." Eugene Peterson, who wrote the message, says this. Listen carefully. Why do people spend so much time studying the Bible? How much do you need to know? We invest all this time in understanding the text, which has a separate life of its own, and we think we're being more pious and spiritual when we're doing it. Christians should be studying it less, not more. I'm just not at all pleased with all the emphasis on Bible study, as if it's some kind of special thing that Christians do, and the more they do, the better. This is the author of the Message Bible. You should study the Bible less, not more. In the King James Version, the word Lord appears 7,970 times. In the Message, it appears 71 times. The Lord Jesus put together appears 118 times, but in the Message, it appears 0 times. This is just extra credit stuff. These four words together, the Lord Jesus Christ. That's not his name, by the way. Lord is his title, Jesus is his name, and Christ is his office, the Anointed One. But this phrase, the Lord Jesus Christ, appears in the Old King James 84 times, but in the Message, 0. The Bible says, study to show yourselves approved, a worker who doesn't need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Paul, in his very last letter to Timothy, would say, he would warn him over and over again. 2 Timothy was the last letter that Paul wrote. Months later, he would be killed by Rome. And he would say to Timothy, there in the last portions of the scripture, he says, bring that cloak. It's so cold here in this Roman prison. But he says, especially bring the parchments, the scriptures. And so in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 2 through 4, he would say, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and teaching. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. Did you know you have to endure sound doctrine? Yeah, bud, I'm enduring it right now. It's something that takes endurance. But the Bible says that the time will come where people will not endure sound doctrine. And he goes on, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers, and their ears will turn away from the truth and be turned aside to fables. There's never been a time in the church, in all of church history, when we've been so saturated with versions, but so starved with the word. All across the country, there are churches who preach and teach the word of God faithfully, and as much, and even if not more, there are so many Christians who are being fed a sad substitute for the Word of God. There's a lowering of truth for the sake of numbers. There's less gospel, more gimmicks, less preaching, and more plays. But if truth doesn't rule in the church, where will it rule? We are to be the pillar of truth in the world. And when we come into the doors here, we study the Holy Word of God. I'll give you a forecast for South Shore Christian Fellowship. We will study the Word of God till the end. Week after week, chapter after chapter, verse by verse. And we're going to close with Jeremiah chapter 23, if you'll turn there with me. Jeremiah 23, he lived in days like ours. God said in chapter 1, I am watching over my word to perform it. And Jeremiah would be told in chapter 23, verse 28, God says to him, the prophet who has a dream, let him dream. And he who has my word, let him speak my word faithfully. What is the chaff to the wheat, says the Lord? Is not my word like a fire, says the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks the rock in pieces? There are many who are peddling the word of God. I have a dream. I have something to say. I have a special insight. And God would say, hey, if somebody has a dream, fine. But a dream compared to the word of God is chaff. Have you ever eaten chaff? I haven't. But I remember when I was in Poland and we walked through the wheat fields and we grabbed the grains, the heads of wheat, and we crushed them in our hands. And as a result, you would have two things in your hand. You would have grain, which we ate. It was real granola. And you would have chaff. And you can choke on chaff. And God's word is like wheat. It nourishes our soul. But so many are being fed chaff, worthless things, people's opinions, stories, stream of consciousness is coming from the pulpit. Nothing is prepared. There's no studying to show themselves approved. It's just, I did this, and I did this, and I think that, and I believe this. But there's no focusing in on the Word of God. Even though Ephesians chapter 6, verse 17 says that the Word of God is the sword. Any shepherd, any general, any leader would be a fool to send his men out to battle with weapons that didn't fire or swords that didn't have sharp edges. And so the Word of God is nourishment for our souls. We have to read it. We have to study it. Romans chapter 10, verse 17 says that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Jesus would say in his prayer to the Father in John chapter 17, sanctify them by your truth. Your Word is truth. 1 John chapter 2, verse 14, John says, I have written to you, young men, because you are strong. Why are you strong? Because the Word of God abides in you. And that applies not to young men only, but to old men and kids and young women. It applies to everybody, because when the Word of God abides in you, lives in you, you are strong and you have overcome the wicked one. We will stand on the Word of God here. We will study it. We will go through it verse by verse, chapter by chapter, book by book. Study to show yourselves approved. Workmen and workwomen approved unto God. No need to be ashamed. Rightly dividing the Word of truth. Father in heaven, we thank you for this day. We thank you that you have given to us your Word. We thank you, Lord, that there's no book like it in all of history and for all of eternity. And Jesus, you yourself said, you are the author, Lord, of the Word. You are the Word. So, Lord, as we study your Word and we look at how important it is, really we seek to know you, because you are the Word of God made flesh, crucified, buried, resurrected, ascended. And so, Lord, we seek to know you better. We pray that you'd give us a strong hunger for your Word. For your promise in the Scripture is, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. And so, Lord, give us a thirst. Give us a hunger to read your Word and to know your Word, and to not be hung up on chaff, and not to be hung up on the things that don't matter in this world, Lord, but to hunger and thirst for your Word. We thank you for this in Jesus' name.